Well, good morning. Welcome to South Bay Community Church. Again, if you are new this morning, this is your first time, we welcome you guys. Thank you for joining us for worship. I want to ask a question. How many of you guys have ever heard of the term or the phrase, taking up the mantle or assuming the mantle? Have you guys heard that phrase before? Yeah, it basically means, it's a modern day idiom where one person carries on the responsibilities or the roles of someone who had gone before them. So when you take up their legacy and you continue what they started, that's what it means to take up the mantle. Now, how many of you guys have ever heard of the phrase mantle grabbing? Have you guys heard that mantle grabbing, or also known as grave sucking? It's this weird idea. It's this weird idea that some people believe that you can go to the gravesite of a famous Christian in the past and somehow suck out of their grave or grab their mantle. You can grab the anointing that God had on that person. Any residue spiritual blessing that's still left on that dead corpse, you can take for yourself. For example, here's a picture of a particular pastor's wife who posted this on her Instagram, laying on the grave of C.S. Lewis. This guy, this great Christian author who had great influence in the world, and she thinks by laying there she can get his anointing and now bless the world the way C.S. Lewis did. Here's a picture of a few students, and they're at the grave of a great evangelist named Evan Roberts, who was an evangelist during the Welsh Revival, brought thousands of people to Christ, and they're trying to reap his anointing, his blessing, his ministry, so that they too can go evangelize. Now, I just want to say straight up, this is just weird. This is bizarre, okay? And the question is, where do you get such an idea, such teaching, right? And they'll point you, I've done research, they'll point you to 2 Kings chapter 13. Now in 2 Kings chapter 13, there's a story where this great prophet named Elisha died. And so he's in this grave, and these people happen to take the dead body of another man and throw it into the grave where Elisha's bones were. And by chance, that dead body touched the bones of Elisha. And at that moment, the Bible says, it's there, it says that that man was revived and he came to life. And they say, look, if it could happen to Elisha's body, his dead body, then today we can go to dead bodies and reap the anointing. Now, I'm going to go ahead and say, I'm going to call that out and say that's false teaching. And that's strange and is weird and is completely unbiblical. And I'm going to say that's one of the worst interpretations of scriptures I've ever heard. And it's misleading a lot of people. Even charismatics in the charismatic movement will call them out as being hyper-charismatic and going way too far, because there are no biblical grounds for grave sucking or mantle grabbing. So no, you can't go to a grave of a man like Elisha and reap his blessing, his anointing. But let me tell you what the Bible does say. Let me tell you what the Bible does say about Elisha's anointing and his blessing. The Bible actually tells us that he got his blessing and anointing from another man who went before him named Elijah. Okay? Now, write this down. I'm going to put a key up for you. You guys want to jot this down on your notes somewhere, because it's going to get confusing. The name sounds so familiar. Just write this down somewhere. Elijah is the older prophet, and Elisha is the younger prophet. I'll do my best to enunciate it so you can hear who I'm talking about. But just so you know, Elijah is the older one. Elisha is the younger one. Now, here's what the Bible says. Elisha received the anointing and the blessing from Elijah, not by grave sucking or mantle grabbing from Elijah's grave while he was dead. But the Bible tells us that Elisha received the anointing and the blessing from Elijah while Elijah was alive, because Elijah walked with him, and he didn't have to have his mantle grabbed from his grave, but while he was alive, he walked alongside with him, and he passed the mantle. And Elisha took up his mantle. Today we are continuing our series called Life Together, and I've titled today's message, Passing the Mantle from Mentor to Mentee. Passing the mantle from mentor to mentee. And my hope and my dream is that this church would be a community where older men and women in the faith take on younger men and women of faith under their wings, that there would be a culture of mentorship in this church. And so before I get into the scriptures, I want to ask, would you guys bow with me? And let's just pray that the Lord would be our divine mentor and teach us right now. Let's pray. But God, we just come before you right now. We ask that you would speak to every soul in this room right now, Lord, that you would help us to see that this is not just a message for the guy next to me or the woman to my left, but this is actually something you're speaking to me about. That as much as I need someone to mentor me in my life, I too need to mentor somebody else. That you've given us these up-down relationships in the church for the purpose of taking us deeper, but you don't want us to stop there. You want us to reach out further. So speak to us, God. I pray that every one of us would see that this message speaks directly to me. And so, Lord, we ask that your spirit would be our teacher, that nothing I say will be remembered or shared or counted significant unless it's true and unless it's coming straight from your heart through your words. So we pray this in the powerful name of Jesus. We all say, amen, amen. Let me give you a definition of mentoring as it relates to this message. This is spiritual or Christian mentoring. This is how I'll define it. Look what it says, and you might want to fill this in your notes that you got as you walked in. But a relationship of trust in which the mentor guides the mentee to grow in God's truth and in God's image in order to fulfill God's purposes. In other words, this is a trust relationship between someone of a previous generation along with someone in a following generation. And the whole purpose is to help that person and the generation behind you to grow and develop in all the ways God has designed for you to grow according to his purposes. So let me give you just a few suggestions of what a mentoring relationship could look like in this church. Here's my first suggestion. Would you write this down in your notes? The mentor should descend from the stage. The mentor should descend from the stage. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, see, Tim Elmore, he's an author in leadership, and here's one thing he noticed about millennials these days. Millennials are people who are born in the 80s or 90s. Generally, they're in the 20s or 30s now. But here's what he noticed about them. He said they're not looking for a sage on the stage. They're looking for a guide by their side. In other words, they're not looking for this guy to preach to them or this woman to lecture them so much as they're looking for someone to come alongside them and just do life on life. Life together with them. And I just want to say that's not a millennial idea. That's not a modern day idea. I want to take you back 3,000 years to the book of 2 Kings. If you have your Bible, turn with me to 2 Kings. We're going to be here for a while. Chapter 2. I want to show you the mentor relationship between Elijah and Elisha. Okay, here's what it says in verse 1. It says, now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elisha, please stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel. But Elisha said, as the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you. So they went down to Bethel. Now you can pause right there. I'm going to put up a map for you guys so you can see what's going on. So Elijah, the prophet, is with this guy, Elisha, and he says, look, Elisha, you need to stay here because God's calling me on a journey to Bethel. And he says, no, as long as the Lord lives, as long as you live, I'm not leaving your side. I'm going with you. He says, okay, come on, let's walk. So they journey, they talk, they walk along the road. They get to Bethel. When they get to Bethel, if you read on in 2 Kings, he says, okay, Elisha, you need to stay here because now the Lord is calling me onward on a journey to Jericho. He says the same thing. He says, no, as surely as the Lord lives and as long as you live, I will not leave you. And so Elijah says, sure, come along with me. Let's walk and let's talk. And so they go along the road. And when they get to Jericho, Elijah says, okay, look, you need to stay here at Jericho because God is calling me onward to cross the Jordan River. He says, no, as long as the Lord lives and as long as you live, I will not leave your side. And he says, okay, and so they walk and they talk and they journey all the way to the bank of the Jordan River. Now, scholars tell us, looking at the biblical timeline, that for 6 years, Elijah took Elisha by his side, took him under him, and he walked with him and mentored him. Now, here's the thing. Nowhere in Scripture do we ever see Elijah preaching or lecturing to Elisha. We just don't see that at all. It might have happened, but we don't see it. But what we do see is Elijah coming alongside Elisha, and the both of them just walking along and journeying, doing life together. That's what we do see. And I just want to say, people, even back in the Bible days, weren't so much in need of a sage on the stage, but they just need a guide by their side. And I want to encourage some people here today, because you might feel intimidated right now, because you're thinking, can I ever be a mentor? And some of you are thinking, I am not one to be a mentor. I am not equipped with the word or with God's truth to be able to pour into someone or teach someone. And I want to challenge that. I want to challenge that today. See, because the reality is, as a good mentor, as an effective mentor, you don't have to be a teacher necessarily. That'd be great. But you don't have to be a teacher, nor do you have to have all the answers. In fact, an effective mentor, I believe, doesn't have to have all the answers. You just have to ask a lot of questions. And if you could just ask the right questions, considerate, thoughtful questions, then one of the best things you can do as a mentor for somebody in a generation behind you is to get them to process, to think about, and to even speak the very things that God has already been doing in their heart and in their lives and teaching them. And if you could ask the right questions and get them to come up with it, sometimes life is changed not so much by what they hear, but by what they say. I look at an example this past week. I got a phone call from a friend who called me up and he said, "Hey, Greg, I'm about to go back to Indonesia. Would you be able to eat lunch?" And I haven't talked to him in a while. I haven't seen him in a while because he's a missionary in Indonesia. He just happened to be here for the weekend. And he said, "I have some time on Tuesday." And he said, "Would you join me?" And to be honest, I was like, in my mind, I really don't have the time right now. I'm supposed to prepare a sermon on mentoring, a message on mentoring, and I don't know a lot about it, so I got to do a lot of study. So I'm thinking, I don't have time for lunch. But I'm thinking, okay, don't be selfish. He's going to Indonesia. I'm not going to see him for a while. So we actually end up going to eat lunch. And as we're eating lunch together, I didn't ask him anything. I didn't pull this out of him. But on his own will, he tells me, he says, "Yeah, Greg, you know, I just finished my dissertation for my doctorate program. 200 pages. I just finished my dissertation for Biola University, my PhD. It was on mentoring." Like, I knew we were supposed to eat together. I knew this was supposed to happen. And so I said, "Tell me more. Share with me. What did you learn?" And he says this. He says, "I interviewed a lot of people. And I said, if I were to take a picture of every moment you had with your mentor, every time you guys got together, and I laid all the pictures out on a table, and I asked you to pick five out of all those pictures that were the most meaningful and the most impactful time that you had with your mentor, what would those five pictures be?" He says, "You know what they said, Greg?" He says, "You know what they said? This just surprised me." He says, "Number two, eating together." He says, "Eating together was the second most meaningful activity." Why? Well, we were talking about that, explaining that when you eat together, you'll be surprised by what kind of unplanned life conversations come up. I mean, you could go through a curriculum with your mentee, and that's great too, but sometimes that ties you to a certain idea. But when you're at the table and you're just asking questions, "How are you doing? What have you been going through?" You'll be surprised at what kind of unplanned life conversations come up. Number one, you know what number one was, Greg? He asked me, he's like, "This surprised me too." Number one was praying together. And he made a distinction. He says, not praying for me, not when my mentor prayed for me, but when my mentor prayed with me. He came alongside me and prayed with me. And he told me, his name is Leo. Leo told me, he said, "Greg, when you ask the simple question, how can I pray for you? That person's heart comes out." You'll be surprised. If you just consistently ask the question, "How can I pray for you?" Man, all sorts of cans are opened up. All sorts of doors are opened up. All sorts of emotions will eventually come out by that simple question, "How can I pray for you?" And I just want to say, when you decide to do life on life with someone in the generation behind you, you'll be surprised at what kind of wisdom, what kind of knowledge, what kind of experiences, what kind of truth comes out. You're going to realize as a mentor, you're more of an expert in certain areas than you ever knew you were. just because you were able to talk through that with somebody. But also, you'll be surprised at what kind of experiences, what kind of knowledge, what kind of truth comes out, not only from the mentor, but from the mouth of the mentee. And sometimes the most powerful things are the things that you can get a younger person to really think about and process and come to a conclusion in their own hearts. And when they speak it, sometimes it's more life-changing than the things that they hear. Jesus, the master mentor, amen? He asked 307 questions in all of the Gospels. You look at it, he has 307 questions. That's way more than the answers he ever gave out. He has more questions than answers he gave out. So when somebody came to him with a question, Jesus answered their question by asking a question. When he had a powerful truth to teach, how did Jesus teach it? He taught by asking a question. Well, by the way, let me just give you a hint. When Jesus asks a question, it's not because he's lacking information. It's not because Jesus just needs to know from you. No, it's oftentimes he's setting up to lay on you a powerful, powerful truth. A couple weeks ago on my Facebook page, I just wrote a little tribute, and I was just thankful to God, and I was expressing my thankfulness for providing a mentor for me and Pastor Gary. And I was saying, you know, all my life I wanted someone to lead me and teach me how to lead and how to teach other people. And I thank God that God has allowed me and Pastor Gary to meet and work together. And the next day, after I posted that, Pastor Gary came into my office. He was just really thankful. He came, gave me a big hug. He says, man, I love you, man. Thank you. Thank you for those kind words. But he said this. He sat down on my couch and he says, but I just got to say this. I never saw myself as your mentor. I never intended to be your mentor. He says, I see us simply as just friends. We're just friends. And I get that. Pastor Gary never once said to me, let me be your mentor. Or being the Star Wars geek he is, he never said, mentor I am. Student you are. No, he never said that. He never said, Greg, let me teach you how to be a pastor. But the greatest thing he has done to help me grow as a young pastor is simply invite me alongside and just allow me to pastor with him. And as we pastor together, along with the other great pastors on our staff, inevitably situations come up. And I've noticed that more often than Gary teaches me something, he asks me. And there will be situations that come up where he'll ask, hey, so what would you say to a person who's going through this right now? How would you counsel this person who's struggling with this right now? And sometimes he's honestly just asking for my input. Sometimes he doesn't know the answers to these questions, but he wants to collaborate and let's process this. And sometimes I've noticed that he'll ask a question when he already knows the answer. A few weeks ago, we were in the office and we're sitting around as staff and he asked a question. He said this. He said, what if you were to do a funeral and the person that passed away, to our knowledge, never knew Jesus Christ, never professed Christ as Lord? And all the people who came to that funeral didn't profess Christ as Lord. What would you say? And people went around and gave their answers. And that caused me to really have to think about that and process that. And how would I give the most honest, most truthful, yet the most respectful and dignifying message at a funeral like that? Well, last Saturday, I had one of the hardest assignments I've ever had as a pastor here. Because I did a funeral for a man who, to our knowledge, never accepted Jesus Christ. And we knew that the majority, probably 98, 99% of the people who came into that place did not believe Jesus as Lord and Savior. In fact, there was a Facebook post that went out announcing to the people who had come, please do not wear your pentagram t-shirts, your Slayer t-shirts, and your death metal gear, because that's the kind of people who are going to be coming. Here's what Gary said in that conversation. Pastor Gary said, you know what I would say? I would say the one thing we know is true with all our hearts, that God loves that person so deeply and so intensely that he gave his one and only son to come and die so that he would have the opportunity to be forgiven. And that became the thrust of the message I gave last weekend. And I tell you, I was scared walking in. And I gave that message, and I told them how deeply God loves each and every one of you. And as I walked out there, people came, and they came and were thankful. Thank you for those words of comfort. I just want to say, if any of you are scared to be a mentor, I just want to say, you don't need to be a sage on the stage. In fact, I would suggest you descend from the stage, because some people just need a guide by their side who's going to do life on life with them and maybe just ask some questions. Amen? So that's my first suggestion. Here's my second suggestion of what a mentor relationship can look like. Write this down. The mentor should desire a double portion. So not only should the mentor descend the stage, but he should also, or she should also desire a double portion. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, as Elijah and Elisha are there at the bank of the Jordan River, they're there at the river, Elijah takes off his cloak. It's also known as a mantle, by the way. He takes off his mantle and he strikes the water. The waters part, and now they start journeying across the Jordan River. Now, as they're going across that Jordan River, Elijah knows his time is about to be up. He's about to be taken from God, taken to God. And here's what he says to Elisha in verse 9 as they're crossing. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Ask what I shall do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let there be a double portion of your spirit on me." Pause right there. In other words, what he's asking his mentor, he's saying, "I want a double portion of your anointing. I want a double portion of the spiritual blessing you've had. I want a double portion of your ministry. Everything you've experienced, Elijah, I want that and more." Now, that's a bold request, right? On the surface of it, sounds a little prideful, but here's what Elijah says in response. Verse 10, he said to him, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it shall be so for you. But if you do not see me, it shall not be so." So pause right there. In other words, Elijah is like, what you're asking, you want a double portion of what God's given me. That's a big request. That's a bold, difficult request. But he says this, but it's not impossible. It's not impossible, because if you see me being taken from you, it will be given to you. In other words, the implication is, if you keep your eyes on me and you keep walking with me and you don't leave me and you stay by my side all the way till I'm gone, you will receive a double portion. Well, verse 11 says this, "And as they still went on and talked, behold, chariots of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven." And in this moment, we hear this famous story where Elijah, just one out of two men in the entire Bible who didn't die a natural death, but was taken into heaven, was taken before Elisha's eyes. And at that moment, the scripture says, Elisha cries out, "My father, my father." He rips off his clothes. "My father." Not because Elijah, his biological father, because he wasn't. But what he was saying, my spiritual father, my mentor, is being ripped from me. And as God takes Elijah up into heaven, the scripture says his mantle, his cloak, was left right there by the Jordan River. And when Elisha saw his mentor's mantle, guess what Elisha did? He took up the mantle. He picked up the mantle, he assumed the mantle, and he put it around himself. And this is where our modern day idiom comes from. Picking up the mantle, taking up the mantle comes from this story. Because from that day forward, Elisha becomes now the prophet of God to speak to the people just the way his mentor Elijah did. Now my question is, as the scriptures say, when he put on that mantle, that's just a physical thing, but people observed the spirit of God that was in Elijah. The anointing that Elijah had is now on Elisha, and people saw that. Now my question is, was it a double portion? Remember he asked for a double portion. Was it a double portion? Well, check this out. Commentators will tell you, this is why I love the Bible. You read through all the Old Testament. How many miracles do we read Elijah performed? Anyone know? 14 miracles. Count them all up. Elijah performed 14 miracles. You counted all of how many miracles did Elisha perform? 28. Exactly 20, exactly double the ministry that God did through Elijah, he did in Elisha, a double portion. And I just want to say, mentors, if you ever mentor anybody, you ought to long and desire for the person in that following generation to do way more than you ever did or you ever could. I want to put back the definition for you again of what a mentoring relationship should look like. It's a relationship of trust in which the mentor guides the mentee to grow in God's truth and God's image in order to fulfill God's purposes. Now, when you hear that, who's the emphasis here? Let me tell you, this is not the mentor, and it's not the mentee. This is all about God and his glory and his gospel and his kingdom expanding for the purposes of God. How can I pour into you to help you be all that God has created you to be so that God could be made known in this community and to the nations? This is all about God. And so I just want to say, if you are a mentor, or if one day you mentor somebody, and you're not okay with the person you're pouring into becoming greater and doing greater things than you ever did or could, first of all, I would say you need to come back and check your heart and check your motives for all this. Is this about God's glory? Or is this about your glory? Second of all, if you're not willing, if this doesn't sit well with you, that the person after you, maybe it's your son, maybe it's the person in the college group that you've taken under your wings, if you're not okay with them doing more than you, then what happens is that gets caught. That attitude gets caught. And when they become mentors one day, they're going to have someone in their following generation that they're not going to allow to become greater than them. And when that person one day mentors someone of the following generation, they're not going to want the person to be greater than them. And what we have over time is we're going to have future generations with diminishing quality of Christian influence. We're going to have a diminishing impact on the kingdom of darkness. We're going to have diminishing returns for the kingdom of God if we're not willing to pour into this person so that they can do greater things. Christian leadership and influence is going to be miserable if we're not willing to see them receive a double portion. Now, when I say double portion, I'm not talking like literally double portion. I'm just saying that you ought to desire that they do way more than you ever could for the kingdom of God. I'll never forget the time when we were in my office, and I've shared with you guys before. Pastor Gary and I, we'll, almost every day we're in the office, we'll get together and we'll just pray. And I'll never forget this day when we were there and we were on our knees. You know, this is just a posture we like to take to express our desperation for God. And we're about to pray after we just share about how we're doing in our walk and what life is like. We're about to pray, and right before we pray, never forget this, he turns to me and he says this thing. He says, "Greg, one day you're going to lead this church." And he says, "You're going to lead thousands of people. I know it in my heart." And when he said, "You're going to lead thousands of people," which is a lot more, way more than we have right now. And when he said that, that struck me and left a deep impression on me, not because of what that says about me, but that struck me because what that says about him. Because when I hear something like that, what that communicates to me, what that's saying is that this isn't about my kingdom come, but this is about thy kingdom come. This isn't about my will be done. This is about his will be done. This is about, I want people to come to Jesus. I want people to come into his kingdom way after I'm gone. I want people to come in whether it's with me or without me. This is about Jesus and his glory and his people for the sake of his name. I look at King Jesus, our master mentor. Jesus himself desired greater things from the people after. Look at John chapter 14, verse 12. John 14, verse 12 says this. He He's talking to his disciples, his mentees. He says, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Now, that is a crazy teaching from the Master himself. These works that I'm doing, you're going to do greater works than me. Now, how many of you guys can boast of doing greater works than Jesus, the Messiah? How many of you guys have ever raised a person from the dead with greater power? Anybody? And how many people have preached a message with greater passion? Have you guys ever tried to heal a blind guy the way Jesus heals a blind guy? He puts mud or he puts saliva in the guy's eye and he could see again. You know what would happen if I try to put spit in a blind guy's eye? You'd have a ticked off blind guy with a loogie coming out of his eye. I've never done greater works than Jesus. And yet when he says, those who believe in me after me will do greater works, he's not saying necessarily we will do greater wonders than him. But when he says we're going to do greater works, he's talking about we're going to have a greater reach than him. And you think about this. Jesus came to save peoples of all nations, but he never left the region of Palestine. He came and he intended to save millions of people around the world, but he never held a crusade before millions and preached to millions. He just focused on a few. He just walked alongside a few disciples. I mean, think about this. This blows my mind. Jesus' strategy, his master plan of evangelism, his strategy of reaching Americans in America was to pour into 12 Jews in Jerusalem. That was his plan. His plan to reach millions and billions of Chinese in China was to focus on a few Jews in Jerusalem. And I just want to say, church, if we want to have a greater reach in this world for the gospel of Jesus, we want a greater reach, we all, every single believer in here, we have to focus on a few. Every one of us needs to focus on a few, and those few that you pour into, you ought to desire that they have a double portion of what you have, that they can do way more, greater works, greater reach than you ever did in your lifetime. Why? Because this ain't about you. This ain't about you. This is about the name of Jesus, and this is about getting that gospel to a world who's desperately in need of a great and glorious God. Amen? So, mentors, descend the stage. Desire double portion. One more suggestion. You also have to distribute your treasures. Would you write that down? This is my third suggestion. The mentor should distribute his or her treasures. Now, I know that as I'm talking, there's some young people in here thinking about, okay, so who can mentor me? Who can be my mentor? And that's great. And I just want to say, church, the demand is there. There are young people looking for mentors. The supply has been low, so please step up. And as young people, you're thinking about who can mentor you. You also need to be thinking who you can mentor. Because, guys, there's a lot of junior hires in this church. There's a lot of high schoolers in this church. There are college students and fresh college grads. They need you to pour into their life as well. Now, let me speak to those who are older in both years, and maybe some of you guys who are older, and the fact that you've been walking for a while now. Because some of you guys have already checked out. In the very introduction, when I said this message is about mentoring, you shut off because you think I am not qualified to be a mentor. That's not me. You're thinking, with all my failures and everything I've gone through, I am not fit to be a mentor. But I just want to challenge that one more time. I want to say right now, you have everything it takes by the grace and the Spirit of God to be an effective mentor. Elijah, great prophet, one of the greatest prophets in all of the Bible, definitely the greatest of his time. I love what the scriptures say about him. The scriptures reveal to us that he was no one special. He was just like one of you guys just sitting in these seats. If he were living here today, he might be sitting right here. No one special. Here's what James the Apostle says about him in James chapter 5:17. He says, Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. And he prayed fervently that it might not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth bore its fruit. But what the scriptures are saying is that he is a man with a nature like ours. The NIV puts it, he's a human being just like us. Meaning he sins just like us. He's got emotions and weaknesses just like us. He wasn't born with any special blood, no halo around his head, no wings on his back when he came out of the womb. He's just like us. But you take an ordinary guy and you put him in the hands of an extraordinary God, the heavens open up. Like literally, the heavens opened up when he became desperate on an extraordinary God. In fact, can I tell you, you know how Elijah met his mentor, his mentee? You know how he came across Elisha's path? It was while he was running for his life. He was running from a woman named Queen Jezebel. Because Queen Jezebel wanted to kill Elijah, and he's scared. How many of you guys have ever felt scared before? He's scared they're going to kill me. So he's running, and he's tired, and he's burnt out, and he's drained. And he goes to God, and he says, I'm done. I just want to die. I'm like, done. Look what 1 Kings says. This is the prequel. Okay, let me take you back one book. Turn to 1 Kings chapter 19. This is before he meets Elisha. As he's running for his life, he says this. Talking to the Lord, he asked that he might die, saying, it is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am no better than my fathers. How many of you guys have ever felt scared? How many of you guys have ever felt unworthy? He's saying, I'm no better than my fathers, the generations before me, I'm no better than them. How many of you guys have ever felt emotionally, physically, spiritually drained, tired, burnt out, and just wanting to end it right here if I could? And Elijah would raise his hand right here. He'd be sitting in the seats and he'd be like, yep, that's me right now. I'm done. And God goes, okay, I hear you. I got the perfect thing you need. Look what God says later on in verse 15. And the Lord said to him, go return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel Meholah, you shall anoint to be the prophet in your place. So what God is saying is, I hear you, you're burnt out, you're tired, you're scared, you're unworthy, you want to die, I have the perfect thing you need. Go mentor someone. Go pick up this guy named Elisha and be his mentor. It's like, God, did you not hear me? I am not worthy, I'm not in a good place right now. Go mentor Elisha. And so it says in verse 19, so he departed from there and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen in front of him, and he was with the 12th. And Elijah passed by him and cast his cloak upon him. And thus began, right there, thus began a 6-year mentor relationship. I want to ask, who here feels ill-equipped? Who here feels unworthy, insufficient, and not fit for the task? And if that's you, I just want to say, you just might be in the perfect position for God to use you now to pour out all that you have to someone in a generation behind you so that they can grow in God's truths and grow in God's image to fulfill God's purposes in their life. I love the way Andy Stanley puts it. Andy Stanley has this illustration that I want to just use and borrow right now. But he says, think about this. Your life is like a box of treasures. Your life is a box full of treasures, a treasure chest full of experiences, full of successes, full of failures, full of work and relationship experiences, ups and downs, victories and triumphs and failures. All of us, every single one of us, where you are right now, you have a treasure. The Bible even says we're treasures in jars of clay. It doesn't look like it on the outside, but you'll be surprised at what God has blessed you with. See, some of us have experienced marriage, or you will experience marriage one day. And so you have what it takes to speak into a young couple or a young person thinking about relationship. And some of you guys are, stop right there, Pastor Greg. That's exactly why I'm not qualified to be a mentor, because you look at my marriage and it is not a model marriage. In fact, my marriage didn't even work out. In fact, twice my marriage hasn't worked out. I'm in my third marriage right now. I'm not qualified to pour into anybody and give them advice on relationships. And I want to say to you, you are absolutely wrong. You are absolutely wrong. Because you know more than anybody the pain and the strife and the heartache of a relationship that doesn't go well. And some of you guys who have gone through marriage and you're going through it right now, you know what it takes to make a good marriage, whether or not you've lived that or not, and you know better than anybody what breaks a marriage. And you have the credibility right now to be able to speak those experiences into someone, a young person who needs to hear it, and you may save a person, a couple, or many people from a lot of heartache. So I just want to say you're qualified. Some of you guys have had a lot of success in your careers, and you've climbed the ladders, and you've come to positions of power, of authority, of leadership. Some of you guys have started your own businesses, and you've made a lot of money. You've been very successful in the businesses you started, and some of you guys haven't made as much money. You've tried, and you've had a dream of what that would look like, and it didn't turn out that way. But I just want to say, in all your career pursuits, you have a wealth. You have a wealth of do's and don'ts to lead a young college grad or a millennial seeking to find out what they're doing or what they're supposed to be doing. You have so much information that can help them go down a right path and avoid dangerous paths. My mentor has taught me to avoid opening up Mexican restaurants and just to avoid politics and just stick with pastoring because that works. I've learned a lot, and you have a lot to offer. Some of you guys have had, maybe not marriages, but you've had relationship conflicts. And you've thrown it down and you duked it out with significant others or friends or enemies or difficult coworkers or mean bosses. You've thrown it down with your parents, or you know what it's like to argue with your kids, so you know what relationship conflict is like, and you've gone through that, and some of these relationship conflicts have turned out for the better, and you guys are closer than you've ever been. And some of these conflicts have still to this day not been resolved, and it hurts, and it breaks your heart. And you're thinking, I am not the person to tell anybody how to do relationships. I want to say, no, you are a great candidate right now to help someone understand what makes a relationship work and what doesn't. Some of you guys have been on a journey of faith, and you're here today by God's grace, but you didn't grow up in the church. Maybe you came from a Catholic background. Maybe you came from a Buddhist background. Maybe you came from an atheistic background. You've had your journey. You've had your questions. And I just want to say there is a young person right now who doesn't need to hear from another Christian who's grown up in Christianity and all they've known is the Christian religion. There is a young person who needs to talk to you right now. They want to hear your journey. What are the questions you've had? Yeah, you've gone to retreats, but you've gone through rebellion as well, and I need to hear your story. And then some of you guys, many of you guys, maybe all of you guys, you're scared to mentor anybody because of these. You got skeletons. You got skeletons in your closet. You got skeletons in your chest. Things that you never planned to share with another soul. Regrets, shameful mistakes, things that you don't plan and you hope never comes out. You hope nobody ever finds out. And I just want to say to you right now, child of God, that this might be the most powerful thing that God will use in your life to minister to another person. That this might give more meaning and more purpose and more significance to your being on this earth than all of your successes combined. Because this very thing in your life might be the door, the gateway for Jesus Christ to come in and walk into somebody's heart because you are willing to take this out and pour it out. You have a treasure, everything. All your successes are meant for way more than just you, church. And your failures are meant for way more than just you. Now my question is, God has blessed your life and he's allowed you to go through all these experiences. And the Bible tells us that he works all things for the good of his purposes for those who've been called. Now the question is, what are you going to do with your treasure? How will you leverage all this to pour into somebody in a generation behind you so that they can grow in God's truth and his image and fulfill his purposes in their life? You know what most people do with their treasure? They bury it. And they take it with them to the grave. And I just want to say, if you take the treasure that God has allowed you to have, all the things you've gone through and all the things you've gained, if you take it with you to the grave and you just bury it, I just got to say the value of all this ends right there. It gets buried with you right there. And I just want to say, with all this is worth, nobody can come to your grave and suck it out. Nobody is going to grab your mantle once you're dead. It doesn't work like that. We talked about that already. But you, every single one of you, has this amazing opportunity right now, or maybe in a season to come, to take all this while you are alive and pass the mantle. You have this ability right now to take one or two or a group of people and just pour out everything God has. God is our Redeemer. Christ redeemed us not just from our sin once and for all, but he's redeeming all the ups and all the downs, all the successes and failures to help the kingdom of God, that you would pour into somebody to help them grow in God's truth and his image to fulfill the purposes of God. Amen? Now, would you guys bow and pray with me? And as you guys are bowed in prayer, I want you to just talk to God right now and just say, God, who in my life can maybe mentor me? Or who in my life can I maybe mentor? The psalmist says in Psalm 71, he says this. He says, so even to old age and gray hairs, O God, do not forsake me until I proclaim your might to another generation, your power to all those who come. God, don't let me die, even in my old age. Do not let me pass from this earth until I've poured out and made known how great you are to another generation. And God, that is our prayer. Lord, we pray that you would allow us to be a faithful church that's not just concerned about thousands of people filling these seats, but Lord, we would be concerned about individuals. And that's not the job of a pastor or pastors. That's the job of every individual. So help us to find boldness and courage and strength in you to take it upon ourselves to pour into a few and also to ask someone to pour into us, God. We need you, and we know that you've provided us your people. So God, we worship you. Thank you so much for calling us into your body. We want to do life together with each other and ultimately with you. We pray this in Jesus' name.